FlyQuest, likewise, had a good spring split. They are off to a rough start here too, 1-3. Certainly one of the teams that people were expecting to perhaps challenge those top three squads. And, you know, they did have one really good win against TSM. That is one of those upper echelon teams that people had predicted at the beginning of the split. But still, you know, they are going to need to. And look at the smile on his face, hovering the York against Impact here.
Yeah. You know, it's fine. It's a solid top lane. I'm pretty sure Aatrox is a bit stronger as we wait for the time to tick down and figure out what they do want to play. Sylas, of course, the only 100% champion across the top five leagues in the summer split is Sylas. Aatrox, the most sought after top laner overall, though, and we'll see where that Sylas ends up going.
Yeah, Sylas definitely could go mid or top. Aatrox, we are certainly expecting to be going top. It has not really been getting played in jungle or mid in NA recently. You know, there is still champions along the lines of Ryze. We had been seeing FlyQuest do quite a bit of that split push style. And another thing that has really been developing is Xayah being picked independently of Rakan. Mm-hmm. People are not always feeling like you have to grab that duo together. We've been seeing Xayah Nautilus, Xayah Lux, Xayah Rakan. So even though teams are often then forced to ban out Rakan or feel that they have to, you still have all these other great pairings that can be put alongside it.
Yeah, there's a lot of value here against Team Liquid as well. CoreJJ is really best on initiators. Rakan has been, I would say, his best champion of the year. With Xayah taken up, you are less likely to want that champion. So even though you've grabbed a good mark, you've also probably pushed CoreJJ down his tier list as well. There is the Ryze now picked up for Jensen. We now know pretty much 100% of the time that it's Aatrox top with Ryze in the mid lane. And now what are they going to pick next? What are they going to pick against Xayah in the bottom lane?
Yeah, it'll be really interesting to see where they do actually elect to go. A lot of players are really feeling that it is the Ryze of mage supports, that a lot of these guys are coming back in. People are really struggling to actually deal with Lux support in particular. A lot of players have been talking about, you know, just how flexible it is, just how strong it is. You know, against all in champions, you're going Aftershock. People don't think that you can actually burst it down. Against poke lanes, it can go, you know, Guardian and have a lot of kind of sustain and effective HP that you're adding in a team fight through that W max shield that you're throwing out and hitting your teammates with. So it'll be interesting to see if anyone does elect to grab Lux or if it's going to actually get taken away.
Ooh!
Viper grabbing the Riven.
I love it. Again, the gauntlet is thrown down. We know the Aatrox is top lane, the Ryze is mid, and Viper says, guys, this is a Riven game. I will clap Impact, don't you worry. Brings it out. I'm excited to see this. I'm excited to watch this one play out. It's going to be a fun matchup.
Yeah, definitely very exciting. And both top laners were having some banter in champs like before, so they are certainly ready to go. Viper was playing his signature Riven against TSM in that one win that they do have in this split thus far. He absolutely popped off in that game, was looking very, very good. And there is that Rakan ban that I was talking about. Because it is such a powerful pairing, it does very often draw that ban, but yet people are still comfortable pairing it alongside, you know, the Xayah alongside some of these other high priority supports.
So right now, both teams need their supports. You've got Team Liquid who needs a bot laner for DoubleLift right now, and FlyQuest needs a jungler. So we'll see if we get some desynced bans. You have, of course, double marksman ban coming out of FlyQuest. They get rid of Sivir, who is probably the cream of the crop, right after Xayah. Ezreal, a decent pick as well, but there's still much more in the pool overall. And Team Liquid, are they going to push another support ban down because FlyQuest get first dibs, or do they try to pinch Santorin's pool a little bit? With only Skarner really grabbed up and only Olaf otherwise banned, there's kind of an ocean of opportunity down there. We'll see as the time ticks down what the final ban's going to be. Running out of time, and it will be Elise, actually,
okay.
Because you see there's plenty of physical damage with the Riven. You typically want to win top lane through that champion. Magic damage jungler would have fit that bill well.
Yeah, certainly does. And if you want to play really aggressively around that top lane, as you often do with a Riven, 2v2, Elise is incredibly powerful, really adept at pulling off those dives as well on that top side of the map. I also do believe that it was Elise paired up with the Riven in their last Riven game against TSM, and you know that worked out quite well for them. If we do get a Rek'Sai here, people do kind of give the edge to Rek'Sai in the earlier stages, but it becomes very difficult for Rek'Sai to teamfight into a Skarner because people are going warrior, people are going damage builds these days. If you burrow into the teamfight and simply get ulted up by that Skarner, you can get focused down before you're really able to get much of anything done.
Yeah, and you're not kind of like a Sejuani or a Zac where you can just build a QSS and you still do your job really well. Rek'Sai has a QSS. She doesn't do damage anymore. So that's going to be a bit of a tight fit right there. Caitlyn gets grabbed up. Not a big surprise. She's definitely been appearing a lot more as of late in the pro scene. Lux alongside it. So the front line is going to be only Aatrox and Skarner, with an almost certainly shield max Lux for CoreJJ in the bottom.
Yeah, this is great, and this is actually what they played against with Optic. I do believe when they played against Optic last week, it was this Caitlyn Lux as well as the Victor in the mid lane, and you know they were sieged upon very, very heavily. They really did struggle in that game to kind of deal with some of those strategies. So you know, will be interesting to see if they are going to be able to pull this off themselves. The Nautilus will be the selection here for JJ. So one of the supports I mentioned earlier, which can really be paired up well with the Xayah, it is not, I would say, as powerful as the Rakan. It's more kind of one-dimensional. You have incredible engage, but you do not have that disengage, jumping in and out of fights, as Rakan can do. But that being said, with the root, with your hook and your ultimate, you are setting up for those feathers to then be following up on that with the root from the Xayah. So can be quite powerful in that regard. But that being said, if you cannot all in, Lux and Caitlyn will push you in, they'll be poking at your turret, and they are certainly going to be drawing attention, you have to feel, from Santorin, from Pobelter, to potentially on those roams down to that bottom side. Otherwise, they can threaten those early tower takes, and that is when Caitlyn teams can snowball the game very heavily, can move around the map and really take over.
Yeah, then we definitely have both side lanes as hotbeds for action down here. You can find a hook onto Lux or Caitlyn, some really big damage can be done. Of course, they're going to keep trying to siege you on the Team Liquid side, and on the other side of it, of course, Riven versus Aatrox, going to be a volatile matchup. Riven should be able to dodge away from a lot of those sweet points, the sweet parts of the Aatrox Q, dodge away from the knockup, dodge away from the bonus damage, and that can be very, very aggressive 1v1.
Yeah, it will be very interesting to see how this plays out. Sylas with some pretty powerful ults to steal. Aatrox ultimate pretty good, Skarner ultimate, Lux I think are kind of the main three, but there's nothing absolutely game-changing besides maybe that Skarner ultimate. And excuse me, I do believe that game that TL had was actually, I think, against Sealed G, if I'm not mistaken. So I did have that mixed up. Was not in fact against Optic, but it was this bottom lane that they did face off against and really struggled to really get much done because of the power of the CG. You drop traps on one side of the turret, you're losing singularity, that Lux E on the other side of the turret becomes really tough to approach.
Yep. 41 thing I want to point out, as we get the cheers from the audience to cheer on their favorite team, both Team Liquid and FlyQuest have been very good teams so far this year. I always do like pointing out when it's Spell Thief's Lux. Now, Aftershock is the standard keystone. That's, make no mistake, that helps her stay alive against someone like Nautilus. She can save her Q for when there is an actual fight, gains 30 armor, doesn't die in the 2v2. But Spell Thieves, in the games I've mostly seen of Lux support in pro play, she very quickly has to start playing defensively against other engage supports and gets a very, very late quest complete and gets a very late sight stun as a result. From what I have seen, I've preferred coin on Lux, even though it's less ability power. You get the gold to buy some AP yourself, and that ends up being better. But we'll see how this game plays out. If they can push 2-on-2 nonstop, you get free gold off the turret and you're ahead.
Exactly, and I think it's just super matchup dependent. You know, if you can shove them in, this is something where you can be farming that gold off of the turret. Nautilus, it can be very difficult to all in as this Nautilus unless your jungler is down here, so you may be able to kind of farm off of that Nautilus every time he's looking for a Targon stack. Some of the really difficult matchups can often be range versus range for Lux, where if you're fighting against something, say, like a Sona or whatever, who's going to win those trades, you can't always even afford to kind of walk up and get those Spell Thieves procs, as we have seen in the past.
Absolutely. One thing I also want to point out for any fans watching at home, we are still on patch 9.11, which is no longer the current live patch, so the 7th Ryze rework not yet in play here in this game, so it's the old version where the E deals damage, doesn't bounce as often.
Yeah, and we likely won't be seeing much Sylas anymore after the patch, as he got some huge nerfs coming through. And this may kind of be the last week we really are seeing this champion in pro for a while, and it has been such a huge mainstay. These professional players are just so good at it, being able to not only use the ultimate ceiling, but also this wave clear, which is really what was targeted.
And of course, as we still see ourselves in this game, we've got pretty close on farm. Jensen has only dropped one CS the entire first couple of waves. It's an aggressive ward. CoreJJ, of course, with the wave being pushed, able to walk up there. That's a very, very good trinket ward. It spots blue and Gromp, especially if there's ever a red side start for the opposing jungler. You can track the rest of that path, no problem, and you're almost always immune to getting ganked.
Yeah, and both junglers doing kind of similar paths here. They did a full clear Raptors, Krugs, Red. Now going back to the other side. Xmithie did take an early base, though, to grab the Predator Boots. So he now is going to have the ability, you know, with those off cooldown, to be able to threaten for some sort of a play. But it looks like he did just use it to get back out on the map. And just going to kind of use that for a little bit of a additional power in the early game, whereas Santorin is likely just going to be doing a six-game clear into Scuttle base and make his first buy and then look for some sort of a gank. And it kind of has been more of Santorin's style. This split, I would say, is kind of heavily prioritizing farm, not always going for those early level ganks. Even on that Elise game against TSM, when he was paired up with Viper's Riven, you know, he was sitting at level 7 without even really having attempted ganks. You know, yep. He was very comfortable to just be farming it out.
But this time he's trying, and he is in Fog of War right now. So here he's spotted now by Jensen. Good rune prison gives him space. The flash knockup still going to land, though. And the chains afterwards. Do they have the damage? The Prey Seeker finds them. And FlyQuest grab first blood.
Really nicely done there. Jensen tried to flash over the Rek'Sai, but not able to actually avoid the unburrow. So gets knocked up on the other side, chained in by Pobelter afterwards. Really good CC chain from them. And that is such a good start here for Santorin, who did get to power farm out. Five camps, comes mid. There is the flash, not able to get away from Santorin. And then the Prey Seeker finishing him off before Pobelter would have potentially gone down to that turret shot.
It really heads up stuff right there. Xmithie gets to capture the Spire, but I don't believe took a lot of farm, maybe parts of the Krugs, not even the Krugs. So gets some vision down, has to leave right away. But is able to run around the map now himself. So this is FlyQuest with 600 gold for an assisted first blood.
Yeah, and you can see on the bottom side, Heal and Ignite have been traded. I do tend to think that does actually favor the Caitlyn Lux lane, simply because if you do not have 100 to 0 kill potential, it's very difficult to actually engage on the side of this Nautilus Xayah. So that Ignite has been used, and we'll see if this TL lane can continue to kind of keep them shoved in. The CS, though, slightly in the favor of WildTurtle, very even in that regard, so no major advantages in that way. And it is TP taken by Turtle, so he's going to be the one who can actually TP back to this lane and just try to keep pressure on.
And Jensen kind of susses out, like, both playing so far up, I don't have vision, maybe I should be afraid of Rek'Sai. Mm-hmm. Playing very far from the turret, and suddenly JJ's here, flashes in, finds some damage, and a second kill already on the board, 2-0 for Santorin.
A beautiful dive there from FlyQuest. Bringing up the Nautilus, Turtle was going for a reset. He went back to base, and I think that TL is going to assume JJ is going to reset at the same time as his AD there, but Turtle TP's back to the bot lane. JJ shows up mid. The collapse from FlyQuest coming in from either side. And remember, this is a flashless Ryze. Really nothing that Jensen could do to escape this. He was actually playing quite defensively, but the knockup, the passive auto, the chains coming in from Pobelter, that is another easy kill. And Jensen is way down already. And he's going to be quite behind as far as experience. He's down 12 CS also. And he is going to be a target for these repeat ganks because still there is the flash available on Pobelter.
Yeah, super late tier coming out. So even if he does get the items, it's just going to be slower stacking overall with time. TP, of course, was already on cooldown. So a slow road up for the Team Liquid mid lane. There is FlyQuest now have Centaurin back in the jungle. And okay, sure, he's down 2.5 camps compared to what Xmithie has. But I will take that every time for two kills. You can see the gold. Up 500, plus the lead his mid laner has, 600 gold there. The plate, of course, the assists, both those things helping. The FlyQuest was an amazing early start here, and you mentioned Rek'Sai. Yeah, a bit of a stronger early game jungler, and though Santorin previously this year has been a bit of a farmer, has been ganking great so far.
Yeah, he's been playing incredibly well this game, and you know, it is someone I think that is critical for FlyQuest success because he was so damn good for them in spring, and getting yourself this sort of an early lead on Rek'Sai really can put you in a great position to snowball the game. You're a champion that not only do you have the early success, if you get those kills in the early minutes of this game, you can be 1v1ing solo laners in the mid game. Your ultimate becomes such an incredibly powerful tool if you do get that early warrior completion, and he's really on pace to do just that.
Oh, very good start in the mid-game is Pobelter. Well, he's found a way to get his jungler over. If you watched the LCS countdown at the beginning of the day, there is a soundbite of Jensen saying, you know, Pobelter's a good team fighter. You know, this Cody's on good teams, but he doesn't know how to pull his jungler over. Doesn't know how to, like, advantage his own leads. So, you know, I'm really not afraid of him. It's fine. And in this game, though, ooh, and in the bot lane as well, but that's the big shielding you kind of get out of 4JJ. He's going to withstand pretty much all that damage. This ult could be an all-in for Turtle. Exhaust comes in. He's still putting the Qs out. Finds the root, but has to flash away from double his Q. Flash over the wall as he gets away from JJ, but now Xmithie with Predator Ron is on the way over. This is a flashless Nautilus. There's the first slow from Lux. He's almost in range. He's going to flash, and that's almost assuredly going to be a kill. The shield's not an epic. Xmithie is on the board.
Nicely done. TL able to get kill on that bottom side. It was a pretty good all-in timing, though, from FlyQuest. They had the earlier six on Xayah, and the Ignite cooldown is lower than heal, so they went again with that off-sync. Doublelift did not have his heal available, and they almost were able to pull it off, but Xmithie was down here on that bottom side, and now in the top lane, Viper's looking for an all-in.
Pretty big damage right there as Impact puts his own ult down. They're going to be trading ult for ult, looks like, as Impact is going to walk away and stay higher HP. Viper does very little damage right there, and looks like he's going for a recall.
We'll just end up resetting, but as you say, trade of ultimates there. Santorin going to be starting up the dragon, but here this is one more time. So notice again, Turtle, he had TP back the lane, so he was up in experience. He has the ultimate. JJ has Ignite, whereas Doublelift did not have his heal back on this Caitlyn and this root. Q auto E, pass through for the root, but JJ just can't get in range because of the flash from the Caitlyn. And then no flash on the Nautilus means Xmithie can walk in, flash ult, finish off this Nautilus for the kill.
Good timing by CoreJJ, saves the root until the very end of the impale duration just to guarantee there's no way out. So that was mechanically pretty nice as well. And it gets the game a lot closer, still in the 600 separating these teams as items push through and Doublelift has slightly more expensive ones to compare the bottom laners with his 7CS lead and I believe a plate taken as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, two plates already off that bottom tier one turret, but Doublelift now could be in some trouble. Remember, Nautilus has ult.
Yeah, ton of CC burn now. Zilla tries to net backwards, finds a slow and a wild turtle, and that's going to be enough. Oh. JJ slightly layered his CC and gave just that small win over Doublelift to get out.
Yeah, and Turtle did not have flash. He couldn't actually follow up more there. Will Doublelift stick around, though, because the wave is pushing away from him, which would mean if you go back to base, you're going to lose all of this farm, so they don't feel that they can actually go for the reset.
Oh, Core spots it out and just alley-oops Doublelift. Beautiful pickup there.
Yeah, recalling on the ward. He's going to get sniped out, and you can see CoreJJ already has that support item completed. That did just transform over right alongside JJ's, so you know, being able to actually stack that up pretty quickly in this lane. You know, as you were talking about earlier, yeah, Definitely wasn't an issue for CoreJJ this game. And Doublelift grabbing that kill, being able to reset the wave, puts him in a really great spot. He's going to be close to IE gold here.
Well, game back into Team Liquid's favor. Has the Cloak of Agility. Will not have the Combine just yet. And actually, he's going to stop down for a little bit and buy some other components. And We'll see when that progresses down the line. Stopwatch ready to go here for CoreJJ. He got a couple of assists early on, and that's 10:30 in, so he's got that one ready for himself in case there is a strong all-in from JJ and the rest of the crew.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it just makes it even harder now to look for those all-ins. You know, he is going to be putting more and more points in the W as he does level up. Right now, he's sitting on 2 points in the E for kind of lane harass, and then he's going to be most likely just going pure into that shield, maxing that out, trying to keep that up. And with exhaust, it becomes very, very difficult to look for the all-ins through the aftershock, through the exhaust, through the shielding. You do become very, very resilient.
Now moving around the map though, looking at the next big play is Nautilus with Moby Boots running towards the top side here as he's hoping to maybe turn around Viper's 1v1. Viper is down about 20 CS though. This is Impact in a pretty much undisturbed 1v1, getting a lead here. Good damage under this Nautilus, but now maybe a fight back towards him as the Rek'Sai is nearby. Oh, it's gonna be burned and Impact's as well, used for some move speed. Burns his flash. Does he choose to come back in with Xmithie coming around? No, he's going to walk away and head back to his own lane. So a couple ults born on both sides, but Impact down a flash.
Yeah, being down that flash pretty big. And that is a great ult steal there from Pobelter because now Xmithie can't really chase into the turret. If the ultimate from Sylas goes up faster, he will ult you under his own turret and kill you. So that becomes a very dangerous game. But meantime, on that bottom side, when you send JJ and Turtle up to the top lane, Doublelift and CoreJJ were already pushing this lane very heavily, so it will be a trade of first turret for that Rift Herald. We'll see where TL are going to actually rotate around the map. Are they going to send their bot lane top to try to defend their top lane turret?
Right now, Team Liquid winning through bot lane. Team Liquid trying to win through that one as they force JJ away as Impact rejoins. It's FlyQuest hoping they can win through Pobelter and Santorin, but that has not borne fruit anywhere else on the map. But it's time for DoubleLift to run back into mid and keep using his gold lead. He's got attack damage and attack speed. Those are stats that work against turrets. It's part of the reason he probably didn't build the crit earlier on. And now comes the first plate in mid lane, and he's not even stopping.
Yeah, just continue to poke away at this turret, and this is such a strong way to utilize the Caitlyn. This really is what was done to them last week, and now, you know, showing their mastery of this style, being able to kind of create these zones of control. It's very difficult to engage through Caitlyn traps straight into the Lux, because Caitlyn can create this small corridor where you have to engage through, and then it makes it almost impossible to actually dodge the Lux binding when you're having to run through this one gap in those traps. And if you ever step on a trap, that's a free binding follow-up. And then there's the room prison. There's so much that you are having to deal with in that sort of a spot.
Yep.
So are able to cash in on quite a few plates here. They got two from mid lane, one from top, all five on that bottom side. So TL, you know, really coming out in that regard quite a bit ahead.
Yeah, a lot of great things on my team. Liquid, you can see about 1,000 gold for DoubleLift and for JJ each above their opponents. And that earlier mid-jungle combo that worked for FlyQuest is 600 total across both of them. So it really is Team Liquid really turning this the end of the early game around quite nicely. They're sizably ahead here, and we'll see what the next play for them is. It feels like they will keep sieging with this Caitlyn lead.
Yeah, they certainly will. And now that's IE plus Zerkers complete there for DoubleLift. And you know, while those early moves towards mid lane were great from Pobelter and Santorin, and even JJ making that roam up, the lead has not compounded. It has not gotten any bigger. In fact, it has actually been shrinking over these last minutes. So Pobelter are still certainly stronger than Jensen at this point in the game, but has not been able to really extend that lead thus far. And that early Athenes, you know, normally you say, well, support role doesn't actually matter as much. I do think that Athenes in particular on Lux is incredibly strong, making it even harder to all in, because it is a champion that stacks up that poke damage fairly well. And then you're able to kind of get that additional 250 maximum heal, I do believe it is, off of a shield. So that makes the all-ins even more difficult.
And a lot of extra health can come in through right here. And we've got the first Drake of the game coming down without any difficulties. As Team Liquid with their newfound mid pressure and their already earned bot lane pressure get that one picked up. There's their Infernal, the earlier mount, of course, grabbed a while ago by FlyQuest through mid. But this is still probably the better Drake overall. And well, now with Shelly summoned up, 9 plates to 4, at least one turret will get on the board for FlyQuest. No one is answering Pobelter in the side lane. Impact sitting far enough back that he knows to be afraid of Rek'Sai.
Yeah, there's not really anything he can do to actually defend that, especially with the new ultimate where you have to get a killer and assist before you can revive. Maybe in the old days you could have tried to aggressively defend that, but no chance in this situation. So it will be a turret. But on the other side of the map, you did see Smithy was actually farming away the opposing blue buff, taking away some of those camps. They're trying to equalize the gold exchange there. You know, even going to be able to grab that scuttle. And for now, you can really see the game plan is kind of on opposite sides of the maps. You can look at this pocket of vision as they're going to look for a turtle here.
Ooh, and Flash is in time to not be impaled, but does immune DoubleLift's ultimate damage and is able to walk away. But that's still Flash down. And that is a loss of summoners.
So here's like all this kind of area is really FlyQuest where they have their wards. And then, you know, down on the bottom side of the map, you can see all of this vision concentrated in these opposite sides for TL. And that really was to protect DoubleLift and CoreJJ, to allow them to be pushing aggressively and sieging. You need to be able to know where roams and junglers, ganks are going to be coming from if you want to be up at that turret, hitting that turret. And that really is the Caitlyn's job. So Viper sitting in this flank position. He's being pinged out though, so Smithy is going to look for him. And this line of wards doing its job once again. They want to be sieging mid lane, so that is where they're going to concentrate most of their vision to allow DoubleLift to be aggressively posturing for that turret.
And on the go to the mid lane, teleport used to get someone back into this one to help defend as the siege continues now for Team Liquid.
Also a little concerning that JJ, with all this roam, he's level 6. You know, he's 2 levels down on Core JJ. The carries are level 10, level 11, so yeah, that Nautilus becomes very, very squishy. Yeah. You know, those levels are quite important for a support who doesn't have a lot of gold income. You know, he's so dependent on the Aftershock to be able to survive, but you know, if you do get bound up, you can just die 100-0 very easily in that type of situation, and does now at least hit 7.
FlyQuest pings, hey, someone stole my wolves. Impact's already long gone. Gets away with the crime, no problem at all. That steal's easy for him. Big Wolf is left up, which is most of the gold, but still. Some taken away here as we reset and look at where everyone has gone around the map. Impact, solo into the bottom lane. Pobelter, solo into the top one, shoving that one in onto Sylas. He is not found an answer in a while here. Got a couple of assists. Still does have his farm lead over Jensen, but they've just kind of been trading farm back and forth. There's the last hitting under the turret. And we still sit on this 2,000 gold difference. Now a fight in the bottom river as over the wall goes Viper. Doesn't get pulled back with the chain, and no harm, no foul.
Yeah, and Impact not really willing to make that chase without vision on that side of the map. You know, for now, TL, again, you know, they really have just been centering all their vision around the mid lane. It is really just this line of pink wards across the map. You can see, you know, really from here to here, this is all that kind of TL area. They are trying to deny any forward vision for FlyQuest to try to protect themselves, setting up in the river, setting up in this area, and making sure that they have these really safe pockets of vision where they can farm. And CoreJJ, playing it safe. The Lux E giving him vision into that brush,
yeah,
and then he can step forward and actually work away on that pink ward.
Definitely a really strong thing for Lux in pro play is, mm-hmm. is sussing out where those brush ganks could be. And it's something that Xayah can do as well with her seedlings. And sometimes you just Braum or Tahm Kench and survive it, but the squishy ones can find ways to know what's around the corner and kill those things without much difficulty to their own selves. And that's a positive as they do drop out those wards and try to remove that safety from FlyQuest. These wards getting fought for back and forth, and Team Liquid say, well, over this wall, can we do it? There's the ward. Yeah, we can kill this ward.
Yeah, and Team Liquid, four members on the top side. Viper is pushing on that bottom lane, so they're gonna have to try to send down Impact to answer this. It will be TL, though, taking another outer turret, the last of the outers here for them. And utilizing this Caitlyn very, very well, and this should very likely get Doubleift to that rapid fire, that two-item stage. So he's gonna be at a really, really strong point. This is where I think the game always becomes more difficult for the Caitlyns, though. The Outer Towers, I think, is a much more simple ask. When you then are trying to move up and siege towards these Tier 2s, you do end up in this situation where there's so many more angles of engage. There's ways that you can get flanked.
Yeah.
Lane wards are a lot easier for your opponents to get to then TP in. So you're exposing yourself in so many different ways. And this is an area of the game where a lot of teams start to struggle and really slow down as a result. But you know, thankfully for them, Dragon is about to come up. You know, Baron will be on the map in 30 seconds. So there are ways that they can try to set up around those neutral objectives and get advantages there instead of having to force for a Tier 2 immediately.
And it seems likely as the outer turrets are gone, and as you mentioned, these next neutrals coming up, we're seeing a lot of Team Liquid, and pretty much where the Caitlyn goes, so goes Liquid. She is bottom river right now, and well, FlyQuest has put their members around as well. It's actually Jensen soloing top lane. The rest of FlyQuest are around mid, so it's now a 4-1 versus the whole of FlyQuest pushing down mid lane. We'll see how much gets done here as mid lane is cleared off. TL can fight for some more. They gotta respect Pobelter. He can flash over, and he's gonna find that first pull, and they're gonna find the damage to the double lift. The stolen Xmithie ult's a huge deal. Goes for round two. Over the wall goes Skarner, barely survives, but no! Viper has found him and finds kill number two as well. Ryze only pushing the top lane. Two kills for FlyQuest.
Yeah, they get those two kills. They likely can get the dragon here as well, but they actually want to respond, it looks like, to Ryze on that top lane. Jensen will get a tier two turret.
They might go
and
Baron.
A bit of a farm, but yeah, they are heading towards Baron. Xmithie is dead. This would be a risky move to make, though. It is 20 minutes and 30 seconds into the game, so this Baron will do a lot of damage, but they are killing it very, very fast with that Mountain Dragon.
No combat ults are up for Team Liquid. It's Realm Warp only. TP brings their fifth member back into the pool, and there is not a smite. They can find Pobelter, though. That's a lot of damage! And he gets himself killed on the TP.
Now they can take
the 3v4. But is there a real chance to smite? And this should be easy, and he grabs it. But now the fight. This could be hard. A second kill does go to Team Liquid. They answer the kills back. But now you gotta watch out for the rest of this one. That was a great opening, and Jensen finds yet another one. Three kills not picked up for that Baron take.
Yeah, three kills for the Baron. This is much more questionable if it was really worth it, because it's how much can TL get now? TL are gonna try to push up and take this tier two. They will get the dragon as a result. So FlyQuest go for the big risk, big reward play.
Yeah.
It ends in a bit of a wash. I would say probably positive TL for now, unless they can find a way to really get something from this Baron buff. But because they are weaker as far as the combat power, they likely can't push forward with it anyway. And you can see those insane Skarner stats here for Xmithie. Has been such a good champion for him over the last year or so in the LCS.
Yeah.
Really making it work for him and his team.
And that is Cloud Drake. That figured as well. A second combat Drake for TL to get better at team fighting. Impact even can try to steal the blue buff. This one's less likely. Santorin has smite.
Yeah.
But we'll wait to see who wears it better.
Oh!
Impact does.
Okay. Surprising, but I think Santorin was just giving the respect that, hey, what if Lux is at that corner? What if there's someone there? Here's the play again from Pobelter. Really nice stuff from him. Goes over the wall, flash Skarner ultimate onto Doubleift. And at that point, you're saying, all right, bail out. get out if you can. There's no way you're going to actually win that team fight with Doublelift dead instantly. So they do commit to the split push. And this is where FlyQuest is debating exactly what they want to do. They decide they're going to go to the Baron. They TP back into Sylas. But Pobelter TPs right in the face of the three members of Team Liquid and gives up a very easy kill. From there, with Viper really low, with Santorin at half health, Team Liquid can easily take that fight, despite the fact that it is the 3v4. They knock down JJ. They're able to use the Ryze ultimate in chase. Jensen flashing over, cleaning up another kill. So three kills there for TL, knocking off a lot of Baron buffs as well, then taking the tier 2 mid, the Dragon. But FlyQuest does have a little bit of Baron time. A minute 20 here remaining or so on that buff. So we'll see if they can actually utilize it to get any sort of an advantage. And they have gotten two turrets to their credit, so a very minor advantage in the gold taken with this Baron power play, but still, you know, not the most effective.
Sure, of course. Those trade kills that Team Liquid got were really big. Yeah. That was I think, cataclysmic, because it was not only, you know, more than 1,000 gold of kill credit, but the three Baron buffs off means a ton as well.
Yeah, it really does, especially because they took it off both the soul laners, so split pushes actually knocked down quite a bit. Yep. But it's not to say that it was a poor attempt from FlyQuest. I actually think if Pobelter didn't get picked going in, they probably just take the Baron and get out.
He steals Realm Warp and they leave together.
Yeah, like you can't actually engage into that 3v5, but because they got the free kill on Pob, they were able to really kind of make that look a lot better for them. So certainly a costly mistake from him either way. Game fairly close to parity, but Doublelift at a strong point. And when you do look at the Dragon's in combat move speed, as well as the additional ADAP, is favoring TL as well.
For sure. 3,000 gold lead puts Team Liquid in the driver's seat here. Certainly, FlyQuest have fought valiantly. There have been glimmers of hope, but they've got to come back from a deficit now. As bot lane tier 2 falls, the Baron buff times out at a pretty much neutral Baron power play, all things considered.
Yeah, Pobelter continuing to push. He does not have TP, but it doesn't matter because TL did not elect to continue that push. They will actually go back to answer. So very likely, we'll get a lot of damage down on this turret. You know, being able to utilize that passive on the turret does really help Sylas to get a lot done when he is in a side lane and he isn't answered. Caitlyn now for Doublelift here, closing in on that third item. Will be a Shiv. And three items is really where people like to kind of target Caitlyn. It is becoming very strong again in the fights.
Yeah.
You know, people really do talk a lot about Caitlyn's early lane power, but then there is kind of this fairly big power trough. You are much weaker on one item than, say, Xayah. Even weaker on two items, a lot of people will argue. When you do hit three, when you have that crit, when you have a high amount of attack speed, you have so much safety with your additional range and team fights that your DPS is really ramping up and you become quite an effective team fighter.
Yeah, that's basically her strength, is that she's very good at making sure her items are always on because of the 650 range, and so lo and behold, when you get more items, them being always on is a big deal. So we're going to see now, as we get 25 minutes into this game, Baron and Dragon both spawning in about 80 seconds. We'll see if it's Team Liquid playing the Siege game or if it's actually just trying to find the right way to trade the objectives back and forth. You have to assume if they go for one, FlyQuest can try to rush the other.
Yeah, definitely the case, especially with Mountain. It really does kind of help to enable, you know, those critical close trade plays. And you know, when you do need those extra seconds, the Mountain can help in that regard. You can see the early GA done here on Santorin. He did elect to go back towards that before completing his Black Cleaver. That is going to allow him to try to more aggressively trade out his life. You know, the question is just, with the amount of damage that he can put out, you know, with him and Viper diving down, can they actually pick someone off? Because someone is going to be likely getting ulted in peel from Xmithie. You know, are you going to be able to really burst down Doublelift when there is an Athene's and Redemption on Lux, when there is Exhaust? That becomes pretty difficult.
Well, the hope is what Pobelter hijacked again for the third time, and it's trying to find Doublelift. This is a zero QSS team, but they're against Sylas with a Skarner on their own squad. The overall cooldown is a bit longer than ability. He can't steal it as often as Xmithie has it up, but that pick is still available at all times.
It certainly is, but it's also scary going in as Pobelter because he has no QSS, he has no Zhonya's. If you get ulted there, you can be in trouble too, but he's found
Jensen.
He's
gonna find one, he's rooted, but they start at the pull. They're going for Ryze and Flash. Redemption, so much shielding. Ryze is yet to fall. Guardian Angel will drop, but now the re-engage impact puts on a ton of damage on a JJ, and a second kill follows through as well. They're gonna find a third. This is completely Team Liquid, and they're on top of Viper, coiled around him. He's constricted and dead. 4-0, Team Liquid have all the runway they need to take out FlyQuest base.
Yeah, they're just going straight for the base here. Likely could take an inhibitor and then retreat back to the Baron if they want. Would be risky to try to go for the end, but it is possible to try to attempt this. 30 seconds of both the solos. I think we're going to see Inhibitor into Baron. We'll find out what kind of a play TL want to make, though.
You know, it's at least Inhib based on posturing there. They're running forward on the turret. They know WildTurtle is now with JJ. Yep. And yeah, with Rek'Sai back alive in 3 seconds, they're going to run back to this northern jungle. There is a chance they full reset and decide to say, hey, let's not really play for the smite fight. But they can easily also get rid of the vision, drop all of these tunnels down, and make that fight all the same.
Yeah, yeah, they don't actually have to attempt this. They can, as you say, get vision, maybe wait for the scuttle and try to secure that. But they have started up this Baron. They are trying to force the hand of FlyQuest. And, you know, Viper has no TP. He's still in base. Here comes DoubleLift.
A million damage and a JJ burning down. He's gone! Oh! Nice ult through from Lux. Now WildTurtle has to ult, try to get away, staying alive best he can. In back in the front lines, takes some damage. But they have turned right away for this fight. Turtle at 1/3 health, even lower than that. And FlyQuest running.
He has ult.
There's the blue smite there. Not gonna go for the pull, actually. I guess they could have traded ult with Pobelter, but that's fine with me, I feel like.
It's like a game of chicken. Neither one of them wants to be the one who gets ulted first, and Xmithie, deciding to go back towards the Baron, wants to take the more cautious play. Didn't know if he would get ulted first. If he does, again, pulled towards the tower, maybe goes down. Instead, they will move over to this Baron pit, and you can see DoubleLift is able to actually hit the Baron over the wall thanks to all that additional range, so TL are laying a trap.
They're getting damage to Pobelter right now. Take some shots with there. They're aware of Santorin as well, but the health bar is so low, he's not going to be in front range. Picked up there for the first one. There's the pull, but it doesn't really matter for his impact. Over the longest Pobelter, chase now down, and the rest of the squad coming in with the Realm War. Put down the backline. You got to watch out for that one. Not going to happen, though. There are no kills picked up for FlyQuest. It's all Team Liquid all the time. A 3-0 already. JJ is assuredly going to drop another snipe for CoreJJ. Says, I wear the letters better. Have a final spark, and this is certainly going to be it. WildTurtle is alone against all of Team Liquid. He can kill some minions, but there's still so much more time to play with. You can blast Kona away. It's fun watching him run. It's a wild goose chase. He is a bird man after all, but this is certainly the base going down. You can go back to the top side as Turtle is going to live for a few more seconds. We're still watching the Nexus turrets fall in a second. The inhibitors are gone. Team Liquid, there's the final kill. 15-4 on the scoreboard. They will improve to 3-2. And your MSI finalists, the three-time LCS champions, are going to be taking down the Nexus. A 30-minute win over FlyQuest.
And one of their strongest performances of the season thus far, Team Liquid really turning it up after that one failed pick onto Jensen. They got so much off that fight.